What's going on, guys? It's your boy Danny coming at you with a quick intro. In this video, I'm going to be going into the subject of melanin specifically, and I want to get into what melanin really is. But there's a lot of information out here coming from specifically within the Black conscious community about melanin. You know, I'm going to be coming at this from a much different perspective. And probably by the end of this video, you're going to look at melanin in a way that you probably never looked at it before. But it's always been there waiting for us to see it. But without further ado, let's go. All right, so melanin, what is it? For a lot of us, we hear this word melanin, and immediately we automatically think of dark skin, black skin, brown skin. We get this image of black people soaking up the sun rays, and you hear a lot throughout the conscious community, you know, it's our melanin, that's the reason they don't like us, it's our melanin, that's why we're attacked the way we are as black people, and you know, the key is the melanin, the key is the melanin. But nobody is going into detail on what makes melanin the key, and what is this thing really? Now, you know, with human beings specifically, you have two different forms of melanin that we can find that specifically deal with the production of pigmentation in the skin and in hair and, you know, all the things on our body that produce color. You have eumelanin, which gives you your black to brown pigments, and you have pheomelanin, which gives you your yellow to white pigmentation, specifically in the skin and the epidermis. And I actually find it funny when I see people say melanated people or melanation, and I know they're specifically speaking to black and brown people, but really all human beings are melanated people. I mean, even people with albinism are melanated. You need to look no further than the albino parent that produces a child with melanin to know that albino people still carry what's called melanocytes, which are the cells found inside of the human body that form melanin. It's the albinism condition itself that's kind of stunting the production of melanin pigmentation on the upper layer of their skin, on the epidermis of their skin. But these people still possess a particular melanocyte cell structure within their body's chemistry. So there are no human beings on planet Earth who do not possess melanin in one way or another. All human beings possess melanin. All human beings possess melanocytes. There's varying degrees, there's different types, but there's not a human being on planet Earth who does not possess melanin within their cellular structure in one way or another. Then of course we find melanin all throughout nature. We find it in everything from the coat patterns of different mammals, in the feathers of birds, in plants, fruits, vegetables, and all different types of insects, all the way down to microorganisms like bacteria and fungi. Even microorganisms are coated in melanin. I mean, we can literally find this stuff everywhere, all throughout nature, all throughout the planet. We find melanin. Then, of course, going back to human beings specifically, we also have what's called neuromelanin, which is found in the brain. Now, there's a lot of debate about exactly what neuromelanin is, but what has been found is that a decrease of production of neuromelanin in the brain usually leads to brain damage. More specifically, it leads to Parkinson's disease, which affects the central nervous system. And your central nervous system pretty much deals with all brain function in general. So when we're talking about the central nervous system, we're talking about the brain, period. So basically, when those neuromelanin cells start dying within your brain, it seems to basically just shut down your brain over time. As the cells die, your brain starts to die, or at least brain activity starts to cease. And you know, looking at that information alone, that neuromelanin seems to be what keeps our brains intact, what keeps our brains functioning normally as human beings. That neuromelanin is basically like the equivalent of what oil is to the engine of a car, to our brain. Without an adequate amount of neuromelanin circulating through our brain, things just start to break down. As far as melanin itself, we know it to be this black or dark substance found in everything that I just mentioned, all this stuff that we find in human beings and animals and the neuromelanin in our brain, all of it is basically this black, dark substance that science has coined melanin. I mean, melanin itself, even the word melanin, comes from the Greek word melas, which literally means black and dark. So when we're saying melanin, we're basically saying black, dark substance. Now, pheomelanin is actually lighter than eumelanin. When you look at a pheomelanin cell and you compare it to a eumelanin cell, the pheomelanin cell is significantly lighter than the eumelanin. In fact, pheomelanin actually has its own unique cell structure that separates it from eumelanin. Now, melanin itself is considered a complex polymer. And when you look into what a polymer is basically this large chemical compound of all these smaller molecules that combine together to create the polymer itself. And in melanin, we find a lot of different elements. You got acetylene, and acetylene itself is a chemical compound of carbon and hydrogen. Then you got the amino acid tyrosine, which can be found inside the actual melanocyte cells responsible for producing melanin, which again is an amino acid, and it's related to protein. It actually helps the body synthesize protein. You can find tyrosine in a lot of things like meat, fish, eggs, nuts, beans, oats, you know, heavy proteins. You find tyrosine in these things, and you can also find this same exact amino acid in the very cells that are responsible for melanin production. But then when you actually look at the molecular formula for melanin, you can see that. So you got carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, all this stuff coming together to create this dark black substance known as melanin. It's interesting because, as we know, the combination of these elements is basically the building blocks of life itself. They say that almost 99% of the human body, or the mass of the human body, is made up of just six elements. And out of those six elements, you have oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, calcium, and phosphorus. Four of those can be found in the structure of melanin itself. So four of the major elements said to be responsible for literally composing the human body, bringing the human body together as we know it, four of those elements can be found in melanin. So you have to think that somebody possessing a high quantity of this stuff we call melanin, this dark black substance, somebody possessing a high quantity of this stuff would have to, by nature, be a more biologically advanced human being than a human being who doesn't necessarily possess this substance in as high a quantity. Now, hold that thought. What I want to get into right now is these elements, you know, oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, and not just these elements, but all the elements. Where do these elements come from? You know, we know these elements are here. We know that we can find these elements in human beings and pretty much in everything. But where do these elements come from? And the theory from scientists is that every known element on planet Earth, and pretty much every single element in the known universe, originated inside a star. The reason they came to this conclusion is because when they studied the elements of stars, they found every known element inside of a star, or at least they found all the primary elements inside of a star. Because, you know, with elements, you have to combine certain elements together to get another element, and they found every primary element, every element you would need to combine together to create this element, that element. They found that inside of a star. Now, we know that the sun is basically a star. We call it the sun because it sits in the center of our solar system, and it basically keeps our ecosystem functioning altogether. So when they tested the sun, which is obviously the closest star to planet Earth in the known universe, they use this thing called a spectrometer, which splits the light rays of the sun into all these separate colors. And each separate color can be tested. And what they found is that each of these separate colors correlates with a specific element on the periodic table. So in our sun, in this star, in the closest star to our planet, they found hydrogen, helium, carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen. Then in even smaller quantities, you got stuff like neon and iron. And again, every primary element you would need in order to create every element we find on the periodic table, they found in the sun, in this star. So from this information, they pretty much hypothesized that if the sun carries all of these elements, all these ingredients for life in the universe, that everything must have been sparked from a star. And even eventually, human beings are formed from this stardust, you know, all these elements clustering together and forming us. Now, whether you believe this or not, and whether you even believe that they have the ability to get up there and test these type of things out, whether you believe in flat earth, round earth, it really doesn't matter. Because what really matters here is what they are telling us through this information. Now remember, they're telling us that melanin in its purest form contains carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen as core elements that come together to compose this polymer known as melanin. Then they're telling us that the human body in general is composed of these same elements, and that a star and our own sun, our very own sun itself, is also composed of these same elements. When you look at the connection between having you melanin, or having a strong quantity of melanin, and then because of that being able to absorb the rays of the sun, you gotta think, is there more to that than just the darkness of the skin? You know, melanin is composed of more than carbon, even though carbon is extremely important. It's an extremely important aspect of melanin, but it contains all these other elements that are also found in the sun. So when melanin interacts with the sun, what exactly is going on? Are they telling us everything that's really going on? Probably not. But there's clearly something very powerful going on when melanin interacts with the sun. And I think this is why you can look at ancient cultures in the past and you can see these people revering the sun. A lot of people think that they were actually worshiping the sun, but were they worshiping the sun, or was there something more going on? Did they understand more than we do today, a lot more than we do today, exactly what the sun really was and why it really was important to them? I mean, you got to think, the human body is said to be made up of all these atoms that come together, millions upon billions of these things. They say we have more atoms in our body than there are stars in space. So we have like a countless amount of atoms in our body that come together and they form these molecules that bond together to create these elements within these cells, which become the foundation for these cellular structures throughout our body. And literally every single part of our body is made up of these cells. Every single part of our body has a cellular structure to it. Now we know that all of these cells come from different elements. These basic set of elements come together to create these cellular structures and to form all the aspects of the human body that we see. But at the core of all of this, you know, just in between the atomic level, we have these elements. And then we look at the stars and, you know, our very own sun, our very own star also carries these exact same basic elements and the very same elements we find in this substance within the human body called melanin. So you got hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, and nitrogen all wrapped up within this ball of gas called the sun. Then you have human beings already being made up of all these elements which are wrapped up into these things we call cells, which are constantly regenerating on their own. But then we have the sun beaming down radiation, which is basically a gas form of these elements being sent through the atmosphere. So you got to think, if you have a human being already on the natural cellular level being made up of all these elements, and then this same human being also has an extra layer of these elements in the form of this thing we call melanin, then on top of that, they have this object called the sun, this star that's radiating these elements. You gotta think, exactly what type of human beings are we dealing with? But anyway, again, they're telling us that we come from the stars, literally. And then we can see in plain sight that this thing called melanin definitely does interact with the sun on a high level. There is definitely some type of bonding between our melanin and the sun, which is a star. And I mean, even in school, starting all the way back in preschool and elementary, they are hinting at some type of very strong connection between human beings and stars. I mean, what is a star? It's a ball of energy. It's this fluorescent ball of energy. And because of all of this energy, you've got these light rays going in all directions when you look at a star from a distance. But then in school, when we're taught to draw a star, or you know, when you get to get up in front of the class and put a star by your name because you were good in class that day or you had a positive achievement, whenever we're taught to visualize a star, it's always like this. 5 points. One at the top, two at the sides, two at the bottom. And you know, when we look at this, we don't really think anything of it. This is just normal. It's natural, right? It's how we've been taught to see a star. It's just a star. What's the big deal? But again, when you look at this, this looks absolutely nothing like the stars that we see in the sky. It certainly doesn't look like our sun. But when you really look at it, it looks a lot like a human being. I mean, look at it. You've got the head, the two arms, and the two legs. And again, this symbol looks nothing like the stars we actually see in space. It looks nothing like our sun. So we have some very, very strong symbolism connecting human beings and the sun, or human beings and stars in general. And when you go into the origins of this star symbology and you go back to see where this star symbol originated, there's actually a lot of mystery surrounding the origins of this thing. No one knows for sure when it was first used, when it first appeared in our history, but we know that the furthest that we can link this symbol back in human history is back to ancient Mesopotamia. And then a little bit further down the line, we see this same symbol being used in Egypt. And me personally, I think they got this information out of ancient Egypt, and that ancient Egypt got this information from even older sources. But while getting deep into applied mathematics, what the Greeks figured out was what they would eventually call the golden ratio. And what the golden ratio is that you can take the measurement of anything natural to the universe, you know, plants, animals, rocks, a grain of sand. And when you measure these things at length, you will always be able to find within that measurement this golden ratio, this golden number of 1.618 in everything in nature, in everything on the planet. You can find this golden ratio of 1.618, including in human beings, within the framework of the human body. That if you measure the average human body from limb to limb, you will consistently come up at this 1.618 ratio. So if you measure from the elbow to the end of the fingers, from the shoulder to the top of the head, from the torso to the kneecap, the full length of the nose to the full length of the nostril, the brow to the inside corner of the eyes, You measure these things on the average human being and you always end up with the same ratio of 1.618. Because of this ratio being hidden within these measurements of human beings, all of our body parts and limbs and things like that come together and they align, you know. Our legs, our arms, our torso, our eyes, nose and mouth, all of these things align because of this ratio that just brings all of these things together. And with the symbol of the five-pointed star, it's kind of used that to show the perfected man and woman, basically the perfected, perfectly crafted human being. Because when you look at that five-pointed star, everything is perfectly aligned, all of those points, just like the human body. You know, they call the five-pointed star the pentagram, and pentagram comes from the word pentacle. And, you know, phonetically, pentacle is very closely related to the word pinnacle, which means the highest point, the apex, the peak of something. Basically, the highest level you can reach of something, that's the pinnacle. And phonetically, pinnacle and pentacle are very strongly related. And the Greeks also named this five-pointed star after the goddess Hygeia. And Hygeia is literally the personification of good health, cleanliness, and sanitation. This is where we get the term hygiene in the English language. So next time you hear somebody use the statement, the pinnacle of good health, you know where that stems from. Then you get into East Asian culture and Native American culture, where basically each point of this star represented a different aspect of human beings that connected to different aspects of planet Earth and beyond planet Earth. You start getting into all these inner aspects of human beings, these metaphysical aspects, and each point represents one of these aspects. You got one point representing air, another representing earth, one representing fire, and another representing water. And then the final aspect you find at the uppermost part of the star, at the top of the star, and that's spirit. So we got four earthly elements, and then we have spirit at the very top. The spirit, the essence of who you truly are, controlling and commanding these physical elements. And so when you look at a lot of this other information concerning this five-pointed star, this pentagram, and you see that how it connects to the pentacle and the pinnacle and being the highest form of the human being, you got to think that what this is really representing is a human being who has disciplined himself or who has somehow figured out how to control, how to direct, and how to maintain these elements, these physical elements, by learning how to control and discipline and guide their spirit, and basically to match the spirit with the physical. This would be the pinnacle of a human being, or the pentacle, the pentagram. And that's why when you look at witchcraft and the occult, when they use that upside down pentagram, that upside down five-pointed star, is because it represents a human being who is being controlled by the physical, being controlled by the flesh rather than having control of their own mind. So instead of mind over matter, it's matter over mind. But again, looking at melanin, we can look at melanin and we can see that melanin is made up of all of these different elements. But out of all of these elements, the most prevalent element we find in melanin is carbon. And we know all elements come in three different forms, either as a gas, a liquid, or a solid. And when you look at carbon in its solid form, you'll see that it's a dark black substance, just like melanin. So from this, we basically got to conclude that the thing that's making the melanin substance as black or as darkly pigmented as it is must be carbon. And then in turn, you got to think, if carbon is responsible for bringing out that black pigmentation in melanin, is carbon also responsible for the darker shades of pigmentation we see in human beings? We know melanin is the key to our different skin pigmentations as human beings. But again, looking at all these other elements, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, carbon literally is the only element out of all these elements that would seem like it would really play a key role in creating the darker pigmentations that we see across the board in human beings. Now again, carbon is black. It's a black substance. But what is black? There's a lot of controversy around what black really is. Is it a color or is it the absence of color? Now, of course, we have our primary colors, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. Because we find all these colors in a rainbow. You can also find all of these colors in rays of light. And each one of these colors correlates with a specific element found on the periodic table and found in our sun, in the human body, and pretty much all throughout the universe. Now, from three primary colors, red, blue, and yellow, you can get brown. You can mix these three primary colors up in different combinations and get different shades of brown, lighter and darker shades of brown. So you mix yellow and red together and you get one shade of brown. You add blue and you start getting some deeper, more defined shades of brown. Then you can even start mixing two different browns together, and that leads to even deeper, darker, more defined shades of brown. But doing all these separate combinations of the primary colors and the brown shades is always going to lead you to a different shade of brown. But you will never quite get black from mixing all these small combinations of colors together. You can try different small combinations of all these primary colors, mixing them together, and you will always come up short of getting black. The only way you can get black is by mixing every primary color together. So when you mix red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet all together, you're gonna find that you will get black. Black is literally a combination of every single primary color. So when we see the color black within our visual spectrum, what we think we're seeing as black is actually every single primary color all combined as one. And you gotta remember, the sun and stars in general emit a spectrum of different color lights. And each one of these colors correlates with a particular element on the periodic table. And black absorbs light. Black is the absorption of light. And again, we have all of these elements radiating within the spectrum of light. So when we see black, we're actually seeing the absorption of all colors, the absorption of all elements. So it's true. Black is not a color. Black is every color. Now again, carbon in its solid form is a black substance, a dark black substance. And our very own complexions found in human beings most likely comes from these carbon atoms we find in the melanin cellular structure. So the next question is, what is carbon in its purest form? What would that look like? What does that look like? So yes, Vanta Black is basically carbon, vertically aligned carbon nanotubes. And a carbon nanotube is just literally a tubular form of carbon. It's basically carbon molecules bonded together in this cylinder form. What they're really saying when they say carbon nanotubes is they're saying a bond of carbon atoms. So we have a bonding of carbon atoms to create this material known as Vanta Black. And we have a bonding of carbon atoms, obviously, in the solid form. So we're seeing solid carbon bonded together. And what that should look like, or what that does look like in its native form, this is just pure carbon atoms bonded together, and what they will look like on the surface in a physical form. The first thing you're going to find is that Vanta Black is considered the blackest known substance on Earth. They say it absorbs about 99.965% of all visible radiation. So it absorbs almost all light rays around it. Any visible light surrounding this thing in its small little vicinity that it's in, it absorbs that. And again, remember, with the color black, the reason we see black as black is because it's absorbing all of this light, all of these different color light rays, all color in the visible spectrum is being absorbed by this color known as black. When you introduce this pure carbon to water, it literally repels the water. Water droplets just bounce right off of this stuff. And of course, with heat, this thing works well because, I mean, it's absorbing so much of the visible light spectrum. And when they test the temperature of this carbon in absorbing all this radiation, the temperature of it doesn't really change very much. And, you know, that isn't really that hard to believe. You know, something being this black and being able to absorb that much radiation and not really rise in temperature too much. But when you introduce it to freezing temperatures, specifically if you spray it with liquid nitrogen, it is nitrogen in a liquid form at freezing temperatures. We're talking about negative 196 degrees Celsius or negative 321 degrees Fahrenheit. Really cold liquid nitrogen. When you introduce liquid nitrogen to this pure carbon, you do see frost build up on the carbon. Frost does build up on the carbon, but unlike a lot of other materials, unlike most materials and most elements, when introduced to extremely cold temperatures, deadly freezing temperatures, most materials and most elements are just gonna fray and they're gonna break apart. The cold temperature is just gonna shatter it. But when the frost is removed from this carbon, it's literally like you never even sprayed it with anything. It looks exactly like it looked before you introduced it to the liquid nitrogen, to the cold temperatures. It literally shows no difference, no change, no difference in the structure. I mean, the durability of this material is just unbelievable. And again, this is simply just carbon atoms bonded together to create this coating of pure carbon, pure solid carbon on the surface. And again, you got to think, with carbon being the most prevalent element found in melanin, and the only element in melanin that we know could produce the dark pigmentation that we see in human beings. So it just makes you think, what would a human being who contains that pure melanin polymer with that pure coating of carbon covering their bodies, what does that human being look like? I don't think we've seen it. I know we see what we perceive to be a lot of dark people out there or black people out there, but when you really look at these people, are they black or are they just darker browns? I haven't seen a human being on planet Earth that is to this point of carbonation on the surface level. Now, none of us, as far as I know, again, were there to see the original human beings or what we would perceive to be the original human beings, if there was even an original. We don't even know how far this thing goes. But just based off of what science is telling us, and scientifically, it would seem like what we would have walking around is human beings that were extremely carbonated, you know, on a level that we probably couldn't even wrap our heads around. It would probably scare a lot of us to see it today. And when you look at what pure carbon can do, again, you got to think, somebody with a high quantity of this stuff we call melanin, which would also give them a high quantity of this stuff we call carbon, just exactly what type of human beings are we dealing with? Now, if you accept that this is what the original human beings looked like, that this is what the original human beings were, then you've also got to accept that anything below that, any skin tones that we see on planet Earth right now below this original purely carbonated form would have to be a lesser version of these original human beings. And just like when you look at the color black and it being an absorption of all colors, when you look at the color white, it literally is the reflection of all colors. So when we look at white, we're actually looking at black turned inside out. Rather than all those colors being expressed inwardly, white is an expression of all those colors outwardly. All those colors are being fleshed out. So looking at that huge variation from black to white, anything in between that would be a lesser degree of this same fleshing out of these colors or these elements. And of course, they tell us melanin itself is made up of these elements: carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen. But how did these elements begin to be fleshed out of the human cellular structure? Because of course we know that eumelanin as a polymer can actually produce both black and brown. But remember, with the basic science, in order to get brown, you have to eliminate something. Otherwise, you're gonna always end up with black. So something had to be eliminated from that melanin polymer in order to create brown, and then from there, you go down the line. And when you look into science, you're gonna run into something called the MC1R gene. And this MC1R gene is responsible for making a protein known as the melanocortin 1 receptor. And this receptor is basically like the most important factor in producing different pigmentation in human beings. It sits like right on the surface of the human melanocytes. Basically, when this receptor is active, it causes the human melanocytes to produce eumelanin. When the receptor is inactive, or when it's blocked, the melanocytes form pheomelanin. So you got to think, what caused this receptor to be shut down or blocked in the first human beings who produced pheomelanin? And when you look at the eumelanin chemical formula in comparison to the pheomelanin chemical formula, you're going to notice that everything is exactly the same. You got carbon, you got hydrogen, you got nitrogen, and you got oxygen. But the one major difference within that pheomelanin chemical structure, sulfur. Sulfur is the one element that separates eumelanin from pheomelanin. And what you will find is that when you combine carbon and sulfur together, you get what's called carbon disulfide. And what happens is that sulfur starts to dilute carbon. And with the combination of the sulfur, the carbon becomes colorless. And I mean, if you don't think it's anything more than a coincidence that the one element needed to dilute carbon is found in pheomelanin, which we're being told is a fairly new melanin polymer structure that was introduced in the last 8,000 years, then I just don't know what else to tell you. But to me, this sounds nothing like some type of spontaneous mutation. This sounds like something that was deliberately executed. And then I know some of you are thinking, and you're going to say, well, okay, that's how we got pheomelanin, but how do we go from this pitch black, pure carbon to the brown skin tones? Well, that's when you get into what's called TPC2, which TPC basically stands for two pore channel. And that's dealing with the cells within your body. Each cell within your body has these channels, these two pore channels. Literally is what it sounds like. It's two pores, two different elongated pores that poke into the cells, and they send ions made of calcium and sodium in and out of these cells in different directions. So literally, you could probably just say two pore channels, or TPC2, is like fuel for your cells, for your body's cells. And every single cell in your body depends on these two pore channels, this TPC, in order to thrive, in order to function normally. including your melanocyte cells. And what they have found is that when TPC2 is disrupted, it causes changes in skin pigmentation because it can begin to affect the pH levels within the melanosomes, and it basically can cause those melanosomes to start shrinking because, again, they're not getting enough fuel. And it's very likely that the manipulation of these two pore channels connected to the melanosomes being manipulated could have been what caused the variation from that original dark carbonation down to the brown and so on. Remember, with black, you need it all. With brown, you have to eliminate something. This is just basic science. You cannot get brown without eliminating something. I know a lot of people think that we started out black and brown on this planet, but it just doesn't make sense from a biological standpoint, from a scientific standpoint. And looking at all of this scientific evidence, anything other than that original black is also a result of the manipulation of that original melanin polymer. So everything down the line, brown, red, yellow, white, all these other skin tones are all genetic mutations of the original black human beings. Now, I know a lot of people like to get into the whole DNA thing, and people want to talk about rhesus monkey DNA and Neanderthal DNA. When you cling on to the monkey DNA thing and the Neanderthal DNA thing, all you're doing is giving credence to the idea of evolution that was originally presented by Charles Darwin. And most of you know that evolution was only created to explain why the darker pigmented races or the darker pigmented human beings were lesser than the lighter pigmented human beings. Basically, that we started out as primates and that we began to evolve into the Neanderthal man, and that all of this started in Africa. So, of course, the first Neanderthal men and the first human beings to come from the Neanderthal man were black skin, and that they moved out of Africa and that they went into the Caucasus Mountains, and through survival of the fittest, they experienced a mutation in their cellular structure. And these people have gone to great lengths to try to keep this thing going, even though it's been proven wrong. There's been some instances over time recently where some archaeologists have been caught presenting ape skulls and primate skulls as Neanderthal skulls, when these skulls have zero connection to actual human beings. And they're still doing this today. They'll dig up an ape skull or a primate skull and they'll say, oh, hey, this is more proof of the evolution of the Neanderthal man and the evolution of human beings. This is where the ape to man idea comes from. And again, you have the whole Neanderthal DNA thing where modern humans outside of Africa all carry this Neanderthal DNA, this Neanderthal genome. First of all, you got to use logic, man. You got to use your brain, even though it might sound real juicy and real nice, but when you think about it, it really makes no logical sense. You can try to make it make logical sense because you want to have some ammo to throw at somebody, but think about it. How do they determine that you have African blood? What is Africa? Africa is a continent. It's a piece of land. It's a landmass. How are they determining that your blood comes from a landmass and from a particular part of Africa, that sub-Saharan Africa? I mean, we are realizing how big Africa is, right? And what all that encompasses. How are they determining that? Or even Europe, saying you have European blood. How are they determining that? This is also a huge continent with a couple of islands attached to it, by the way. And from what I'm getting from a lot of people is, if you have any type of darker pigmentation to your skin, apparently you aren't a part of this Neanderthal DNA thing. Without going and getting an actual blood test, which I believe is BS, by the way, I don't believe that they can tell you your roots from a blood test. But for a lot of people, especially these people online, without actually going and getting a blood test where they tell you where your bloodline traces to, they're running around basically saying that anybody with darker pigmentation to their skin is a part of this sub-Saharan African group that is immune to this Neanderthal DNA thing. So if you have darker skin, you don't have Neanderthal DNA. The problem with that, number one, playing devil's advocate for a second, assuming that this is an actual thing, is that it's coming out more and more, and the same people that use this, by the way, will accept this fact. It's coming out more and more that dark-skinned human beings were everywhere on the planet. We weren't just in sub-Saharan Africa. And through this Neanderthal DNA concept, anybody outside of sub-Saharan Africa would have been susceptible to the Neanderthal DNA. Meaning, it wouldn't just be people with lighter skin complexions who would have Neanderthal DNA, but it would be anybody outside of sub-Saharan Africa. Every dark-skinned human being on planet Earth was not packed into sub-Saharan Africa. I think things like this are put out to kind of keep us distracted from what's really going on. Because when you get into what's really going on, you start to realize that this thing is way deeper than black versus white. I mean, if you look at everything we've gone over in this video, it's very clear why black people are being targeted more than anybody else on this planet. It's very clear why. They know we're basically the closest thing to the root when it comes to human beings and the human genome. These amazing complex beings that we call humans, we are the closest thing to the root. And by nature, you would think we would have the most ability to be a problem for a group of people who are trying to keep control of all of the human beings on the planet. That we would literally have the most potential or the most immediate potential to be able to tap into whatever this really is, whatever this thing we call being human really is. Again, I'll say it again, you know, they tell you a lot with the English language. You means color, and we know that the color black is the absorption of all color, but in its own right, anything below that, including brown, will have to be the absorption of color on some level. So when you look at black, when you look at brown, and even when you look at certain tones underneath those color variations, you are actually looking at different spectrums of color. You think you're seeing black, you think you're seeing brown, but it's only what our mind's eye is perceiving. So when you see these things, you see color, aka you. And what do they call us? You man. What were we called for the longest here in America during all the civil struggle? Colored people. Prior to that, they called us Negroes, which is literally just black in Latin. They know our roots. They know where we come from. They know who we really are. And when you look at the night sky, which is literally just outer space, it's space itself. You can't even really say outer space because Earth is literally just in space. So when you look at the night sky, you're looking at space. And in space, you have this darkness, this blackness. What is the black of space? Well, science calls it dark matter. And they call it dark matter because they have no clue exactly what this stuff is. But they theorize that it's literally what's holding everything in space together. This black, dark substance. But when you look at this substance, this black, dark substance in space, and then you look at carbon, again, how carbon functions here on Earth, it really does just seem like the universe is full of carbon. I mean, what does carbon do? It absorbs light. Now, we know that a star is this super bright, effervescent ball of energy. The stars really should be so bright that we never have a nighttime. If you really think about it, we have so many stars in the sky constantly shining. And when you look at the way that our sun shines, the only reason that we even have a nighttime is because of the rise and fall of the sun over different parts of the earth. Once the sun is gone, that brightness is gone. But if the sun is a star, why aren't these stars shining enough light down onto the earth to give us adequate light? Well, again, when you look at carbon and the way that it absorbs all visible light within its space. It just makes sense to think when we look at dark matter in the sky, when we look at that black substance in space, we are looking at carbon, and that basically this carbon is absorbing a good majority of that light energy, those light rays that these stars would be sending out if that carbon wasn't present. And again, we got to cut the crap with this non-human being stuff. Y'all not even human. Y'all not human. Again, yes, you does mean color, and it also means God. So there is something deep when it comes to this term, you man. When you look at the etymology of the word and you look at the phonetics of the word, yes, there is something very deep going on there. You can logically say that. But then you also have to use logic when it comes to saying people are not human beings. Biologically, it's just impossible for a human being to procreate with a non-human being. We cannot procreate with anything outside of our species. So for you people who say white people are not human beings, can you please kindly explain to me how we can procreate with them? Why do they have the exact same genitalia that we have? Why do they go through the same birthing process? I mean, everything down to nourishing a baby through an umbilical cord. They do it all the same. We have all of the same anatomical features. Outside of things dealing with your skin tone, and for some people, your hair, we can indulge in and use a lot of the same things that white people do, just on a humanistic level, and it will be just as beneficial to us as it is to them. It'll have the same effect to us that it has to them. Of course, there are certain things that our body rejects that white people's body doesn't necessarily reject. Again, that plays into the different chemical compounds found inside our melanin. When you add that sulfur in there, sulfur reacts to different chemicals in a unique way. So you would think somebody that has a lot more sulfur inside their body is going to have a different reaction to certain chemicals than somebody who doesn't. Does that mean they're not human? No. Does it mean that they're a different type of human? Sure. But we're all human beings. And ultimately, it's time that we understand that there's something way bigger going on. That the white people that we see in power, they haven't even been in power that long. And they didn't just magically end up in power. Something happened on this planet. They were placed there. And if you're not in on what's really going on, if you're not a part of that ultimate plan to keep human beings at a low state of existence, not realizing who they really are, then guess what? You are in the same boat. You're being played. And we're all being played. Learning who you are as a human being and striving to become the best version of yourself that you can possibly be is the key. We got to get beyond this. We got to start thinking higher, and we got to start realizing our connection to everything, to the earth, to the universe, to everything that encompasses that. I mean, every single element you can find inside of any other human being, you find inside of yourself. And not just in human beings, but in everything on this planet. So how are you ever going to become the great being that all of us seem to want to become when you refuse to even acknowledge your connection to everything? But yeah, just keep striving to be better in the meantime, and I will be back soon. As always, peace, love, and stay up.
Hit the notification button, and you'll get updated as soon as a new video drops.